Hey guys, it's Al. Welcome back to the channel. Thanks for watching all the videos so far. The response has been great, really excited. Please don't forget to like this video, subscribe, and enable your notifications for more No Good Drummer content. Today I wanted to talk to you about the drummers I love, my biggest influences. Four drummers in particular really stand out for me as my biggest influences over my entire career. Very first drummer I've got to mention, and I mention him because he is the drummer for my favorite band ever. I've seen them probably more times live than any band I've ever seen, and that is Neil Peart of Rush. You can imagine when he passed away how gutted so many people were around the world because of the outsized influence this man has had on music and on drumming. Here's the thing. And Neil would have agreed with this himself. He was not great at everything, and he kept working through his entire career to get better at things. That was really, really impressive to me. As a kid, what was of course really impressive were the huge drum sets and the pyrotechnic chops of Neil playing these huge pieces in odd times with concert toms over here, toms all the way around him, and probably like a ton of cymbals. And I set up my early drum sets like him. Even into my 30s, I was setting up my drum set like him because he was such a huge influence and I loved playing his music and I loved listening to his music. And if it was good enough for Neil, it was obviously good enough for me, right? But Neil never rested on his laurels. Okay, first with Freddie Gruber, Peter Erskine, always studying through his life, always trying new things. Famously, he tried to go into jazz and big band. You know, he did the initial Burning for Buddy sessions and concerts. Didn't have maybe the best experience there, but kept working on it and working on it. It was a passion project for him because he wanted to prove that he could do it. Transitioning from match grip to traditional grip. Another example of reinventing himself. And of course, his varied influences, very famously in the 80s, he got into new wave and reggae. He got a lot into the world music in the 90s. And then also like alternative music and kind of that heavier feel in the late 90s, early 2000s. And just like Rush did, he evolved over the course of the band. I love listening to Neil's very crisp attack on the drums. I loved hearing kind of almost his symphonic approach to the instrument. I loved his incorporation of different sounds and use of electronics and other instruments that are not typically thought of as drum set instruments. So he just opened me up to a wide variety of possibilities with a drum set. And even though I don't play this huge drum set anymore like I used to, mostly because it's a pain to move and I don't have a road crew at my disposal, I think that Neil really opened my eyes up to what was possible as a drummer and as a musician, not just a drummer. I don't think any rock drummer can properly have a discussion about influences without mentioning John Bonham, okay? Bonzo was so much more than just the drummer for Led Zeppelin. He was its beating heart, okay? It's hard to imagine that band with a less confident, less explosive, less lyrical drummer. And that's the thing that a lot of people don't get. A lot of people only hear the power and only see the huge drums, okay? A 26-inch bass drum, you know, this 24-inch ride, this big wall of sound, and they think, oh, you know, it's just slamming and you know, caveman, right? No, John was very, very precise technically. He and his parts really moved in a lyrical way. I think if you just, you know, listen to like Fool in the Rain, for example, and how that part just dances along, and it's just this light-hearted romp all the time. Even though he's still slamming it, it just feels light. Everything he did was like that. You know, the bass drum is just pounding through the floor and hitting you in the chest, but at the same time, he's just dancing over the cymbals and over the snare, and just, you know, his triplet rolls around the toms are a thing of legend to me. And so if Neil showed me what was possible for a drummer to be as a musician, John showed me what it was possible for a musician to be as a drummer. So if Neil expanded the vocabulary of what a drummer can be, and if Bonham expanded the soul of drumming, Gavin expands the mind and the mindscape of drumming, because he takes it into incredibly intricate places that, you know, a regular four on the floor drummer can't do. Gavin has a way of making an odd time that and odd subdivisions and stuff. He has learned to just make it groove and make it feel natural and make it feel like incidental. Like you understand what's going on, even though there's no way you can understand what's going on. But at the same time, he's got this incredibly intricate touch on the instrument that allows him to do these incredible little herdas and subdivisions of 32nd notes, and his footwork is amazing. Because more than Neil, while he takes the same kind of orchestral approach to the instrument, Neil played the same part every single night and almost never varied from it. Very little improv there outside of his solos. Gavin has little pockets of improvisation. He feels his way through a fill based on the night, based on the performance, based on the audience, based on, hey, I just got this great idea and it's gonna work and here we go. And if you compare three Porcupine Tree performances to each other, there's gonna be differences in each one. And if you take a performance at the beginning of the tour, like close to when he cut the album, and at the end of the tour, and they live in those songs for a while, you can hear how some of the stuff really, really evolves. One of my great examples is Anesthetize. When he first played it very close to the record, the fills are very, you know, just kind of straightforward in the early performances. But later on, when he gets very, very comfortable with the music, and I'm thinking like Live in Tilburg is a great example of this, is when he starts introducing, he's got a backward fill where he goes over to the 14-inch tom, or the 15, he didn't use a 14, he used a 15, and he goes back up the 12, 10, and 8, and ends on the snare drum. So he's doing a fill backwards up the toms, and it's like, it is so counterintuitive, but it is so musical the way he does it, and you can hear the brain cells just popping as he does it. So a little bit more improvisational, plenty of thought. I love listening to his stuff, and it is so challenging but so rewarding. My fourth influence is actually now the most established, the, you know, the elder statesman of my influences, and it's Louie Bellson. the original double bass drummer. But what a gentleman on the drums. I had just started drumming in the mid 80s. And, you know, when you start playing a musical instrument, everything is difficult and you're putting a lot of time in and you're maybe not making much headway and you're wondering, am I going to stick with this? Is this worth it? Did I make the right decision? This sucks. I'm no good. Maybe I should quit. And then I happened to be staying up. My parents were cool. They let me stay up and watch the Tonight Show. And I remember Louie Bellson and his orchestra were on one night. And I knew who he was from Modern Drummer, but I never listened to him perform. I'd only just seen pictures, and I knew kind of like the story. He was the original double bass drummer. He was the guy who figured it out. Let's have two bass drums on the stage. But he was in his 60s at the time, and he was like lightning all over the drums. He exemplified to me at that moment what could happen in terms of fluidity and just fluency on the drums if you stuck with it for long enough. At this point, he'd been playing 40 something years. At this point today, I've been playing close to 40 years. And that's what I'm kind of hoping happens most of the time, is that it just gets done. I don't have to think about the sticking. I don't have to think about the footwork. I don't have to think about the notation or the rhythms. It just works its way in because I hear it and it happens. And you could sense that's what was happening with him in this solo. He was just playing and enjoying the playing, and you could see him lift out of the playing, kind of like when you have this perfect performance and you can feel yourself transcending out of the performance and out of the mechanics of drumming and into the, I am here, I'm performing, I'm able to interact with the other musicians, the audience, and enjoy the moment. It's kind of sublimation. It's kind of like rising above, having that out-of-body experience that we all kind of dream of when we play drums. And I saw him having that. And to this day, that very performance, I'm so glad YouTube exists now because I found that performance, what I've clipped for you here. That performance is what initially inspired me to keep on drumming. And now almost 40 years later, not only am I drumming and making money and enjoying myself and having a lot of success for me personally, but I'm able to share that story with you in the hopes that you can take heart in your own influences and understand that if you keep at it and you look at what you can learn from these influences, you too are going to become a great drummer, a confident drummer, and just have a lot of fun with the instrument. Hey, thanks for listening. Who are your influences? What did they mean to you? What's the things you learned from them? Drop a comment below. Let me know. Let's talk about it. It'll be a great conversation. Don't forget to like, subscribe, hit the notification button, and I'll catch you next time. Thanks very much for watching.